Welcome to the Captain Max Steel Show. Captain Max Steel is also known as Max 21D. Intuitive healer, Akashic Records, your galactic race soul family. Those who guide you, those who protect you. Past lives on Earth and elsewhere in the universe. Max 21D performs remote viewing, deactivating chips and codes or programming, raising the vibrations and healing this great planet. We are co-creating a better reality. You're listening to Wolf Spirit Radio.
Robert, go ahead and unmute yourself and come yourself into the chat room and tell us what you've been doing and what made you take those pictures of those spirits that kept showing up. Here, let me unmute you. Okay, I just unmuted. You can talk now.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, Max, for your introduction. And hello to everybody from the Netherlands. I'm born with this gift. I was a child, and I was expected everybody will see spirits and color patterns around people and was hearing voices and everything. And I was also see light creatures many times around people. And for me, it was normal, but later people was think that I was crazy. And also on my school childhood was very bad. They was thinking that I was mentally ill. And then they was give my parents the advice to go to a psychiatric helper. And that psychiatric helper was giving the advice to my parents to bring me to a psychiatric hospital for children. And they was bring me there. And I was get very homesick when I was love my mother and my father very strong and my two sisters. And then they was say that I must stay there. And around the 2 weeks, every time after 2 weeks, I was having the permission to be a weekend with my parents. And that was, nice then. But then they must bring me back to the psychiatric hospital. And then there was a nurse there, and she was say that she was feeling that she must talk with me. And she was say to me, the things that you are seeing are not crazy. You are not schizophrenic, or you are not psychotic. You have gifts. The first thing that I was thinking, I will not hear that. I will not be a witch, you know, and I will be a normal kid and I will playing and do normal things. And I was expected they was make me better there. But she was saying, no, you have a gift and you can live with it. And I will help you to come out the hospital here. And then she was trying to help me and tell my parents about my gifts. And my parents was hearing this more time from other psychic peoples, but they was follow the advice from the doctors. And then they was sue her. The boss from the institute was saying that she is dangerous, that she say that to me, that I'm very sick and that I need help. I must stay there. Then my parents was coming by a person in Nijmegen. His name is Rens Hendricks. Rens Hendricks, he was in his life having an experience with God. He was feel what he was called God, a very big presence around him. And he have not permission to talk about what was exactly happening there, but it was give him the power to help people through pictures and when he give people healing. And he do this now for 40 years. He have his practice. My parents was go with a picture there. And when he was see me, my picture, the first thing what he was say, was I have get a message that I have not the permission to ask money. I must help him for free. I get also sort of love from him back. And I was then, I think, 13 years old. My parents was not tell this in the psychiatric hospital. They was going secretly to Rens Hendricks in Nijmegen, and he was helping me through a picture from me telepathic. And then I was feel in a distance, very strong, a sort of contact with him. And the first thing that I was feel was a sort of surrogate father in a distance. And my parents was not telling me when they would go to him. And every time I was feel exactly the time when he was coming in me. And that was the first time that I was realized who I am, where I come from, and what my job is. And then I was feel that I was not crazy, that I was not a dummy, what they was tell all the time on the school and what the social helpers every time was telling. I was feel that the things that I was see, it was real, and that I was wake up, and that I was not crazy, and that the structures that I was see in the association, the trend set and everything, and that, you know, the laws that we was having on the earth, that I was feel that it was lots of nonsense, that when people talk things in, tell things in commercials and everything, that it is a lie, and that everything, everybody is very afraid and working with big groups to not be different as the group, you know. It's a psychologic frame that gives structure, but it's not the reality, and we have called it association. But there is a larger reality, a very authentic reality, and I was feel that all the time. And then Rens was close my gifts a little bit, and then in the institute there was think that I was better, and they was say, let's give him a try, that he can go home. And then I was going back by my parents, and then I was, it was my gifts was stay easy to the moment that I was 15, 16. And then everything was coming back in the way that I was get a very strong presence around me, very big. It was feel of I was feel the whole universe was coming in me, and I was feel a very peaceful, playful, very sweet feeling. I think the same feeling what people experience when they have a near-death experience. And then I was sucked very strong to some nature place that we have in my village that called Hoeven. And then I was take my bike, and I was biking to some street in that nature place. We call it Paling Street. And then I was sucked to the right part. And then I was see a field, and I was see a sort of halter, sort of dumbbell form, circle formation there. And I was hearing from circles in the past in the media, but I was not sure if it was real, but I was feel this is real. You must walk in it. So I was jump in it and feel a very strong energy. And I was feel this is the begin from much more. And then I was tell it my parents, they was making pictures, and we was keep it still and quiet. And almost a couple of months after that, I was get the same feeling that I must go outside, that I'm, that my mind was almost so bright as the universe. Very strange feeling. I cannot explain exactly. And then exactly the same phenomenon was happening. I was sucked to the right part, and I was see a light ball in the shape of a football, and it was make a sort of spiral in the air going behind the dike. And then I was hearing a sort of electrostatic noise. Then I was go with my bike on the dike. The ball was disappeared, the light ball, but four circles was left there in the field. That was the begin of now I have found hundreds of circles in the same way that I get a feeling before. Sometimes I see the symbols in my mind, how they will look like, how they will look like when I found them in the fields. And the first time after this experience, I have seen a couple of times how crop circles was making by light bulbs, sometimes spaceships, a sort of classical UFO forms, sometimes the sort of flashes they was making them. And the farmers was thinking first, yeah, you are all the time the first person that found crop circles. They was very disappointed, and they was very angry to me. They was thinking that I was make them, that I was fool them. And they were starting to be very aggressive, almost sometimes physical, you know, they were was wishing to beat me up. They was thinking we have a rival, you know, we have some ruminates that make us feel damaged plants. But then Nancy Talbot, the assistant from Professor Livingood, a famous crop circle researcher worldwide, that was discovered that some crop circles have some anomalies, some things in the plants that you can see that the cells are changed, that the notes are blowing up, and then you can see that something is happening, that some radiation is doing something in the plants. And he was testing some circles, and he have discovered that some plants in real circles, the cells are changed. And the only thing that can change cells is radiation and microwaves. And then she was coming to the Netherlands. She was hearing from the things that I was experiencing. And then she was coming and she was telling me, I do now for years research to crop circles, and I have never ever seen that the crop circle was forming. Please, can you ask if they can be more direct? And I was say to her, okay, I can ask that. And then I was asked it, but I was expect nothing, when I know how the universe is working. When we try to push something, they will not come. And then she was going upstairs to the bed when she was sleeping by my parents and by me. And I was standing in the kitchen, and then I was feel a very strong energy field coming. Like it was feels, or I was sucked in a sort of isolation. Then the moment after that moment, I was turned the light out, and I was hearing that the cows was starting to yelling. They was make noise, and I was hearing dogs around the village where I live, that they were starting to make noise. And then out of the blue, a very big beam of light was coming out the air in a bean field behind those house, big fields with beans, bean plants, vroom, vroom, with a spiral in the middle. Then I was hearing upstairs a lot of noise, and then she was running downstairs. As he was coming, standing by me, and we was see how this light was coming in the fields, and how the plants was, you know, do this, and you was see little light spikes, you know, going from right to the left. And then I was say to her, I think that your wish is coming be true now. They are more direct now. And then we was walking in the garden, and we was discover this big circle in the beans. For me, that was very important that the scientific researcher was witness what I was seeing, and that the skeptics was get a more difficult time to debunk me. Then in 2004, I was discovered on a night that I was hearing a sort of electric noise, but then like the flutes, you know, very high flute noise in the living room from my parents. The first thing that was coming up in my mind was, take your camera and take a couple of pictures. I was do that. There was a green chair in the living room, and I was see with my naked eyes a sort of cloud that was forming there. Then I was making pictures. I was watching back, and you will see a cloud, and then the cloud was forming a sort of creature, almost a classical creature, what we called a gray type of creature. After that, other people was coming on the picture. Also, dead people, dead relatives. My dead uncle was coming on the picture. My grandmother was coming on the picture. And then a journalist from a local paper was asked if he can do a test with me. And I was do that. And he was bringing his camera, and he was standing by me. And then also, dead relatives was coming on his picture. And that was makes me very happy to realize that after all the pain that I was having in my childhood, that I have the possibility to be a bridge between the other world and this world. And after that, they have done lots of tests with me scientifically. Also, Dan Drayson was making a documentary that's called Calling Her, about life after the death, and he was testing me also to bring his camera, do self the chip in his camera, and filming the camera in the lens and behind me. That trickery is not possible, and Frederik Jurgensen, the first person from the EVP that have created the EVP, was disappear in the picture on that moment. And lots of pictures are coming now. Some are extraterrestrials, Some are dead persons. And sometimes creatures I never ever have seen appear on the camera. And that's very nice that you can show other people what you see sometimes, and they see it now also. And that makes me very happy, yes.
You know, you mentioned, Robert, it's John in London, but you mentioned the flute sound that you heard there that comes in. It's interesting because I was watching a John Mack, who's a sort of renowned researcher into UFOs, and he came from a sort of science point of
view. Yes, yes, yes.
And he went out to Rhodesia and studied these children that in the 90s had this experience where a UFO came over the school and was hovering. And
oh,
then,
that was in Africa. Africa.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And, very and interesting they, cases. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. They all described hearing this sort of flute noise, which was a strange sort of noise to hear from. You'd expect some sort of sonic noise that you hear in movies and stuff, but it was very eerie. You know, flutes, they said.
Interesting that it is synchronic with my experience when the creature was appear in the living room. Yes. And I have heard this noise also many times when crop circles was forming. Yeah.
Now, one of the interesting things that I remember was that, you know, a few years ago, one of the Vatican members that were working on the in Arizona, they've got a telescope from the Vatican called the Lucifer Telescope.
Yeah.
I can't remember what the abbreviation.
Yeah. I remember.
But,
yeah.
One the gentleman that was working there, someone asked him a question, and he said that if aliens come down to Earth with tentacles, then he'd be prepared to baptize them if they had souls.
Exactly.
And then it was very interesting because, like, a few years later, you know, I'd heard of Robert's case, and then I'd heard about his case with these tentacles.
Yes.
And yeah. It was a fascinating story. I don't know if he's explained this or if you've heard the case, but we're sort of looking to bring that forth because I think when the Vatican made that statement about tentacled aliens, you know, they'd baptize them. I think they had a bit of an insight. And if you look at Men in Black, you know, there's in that very first scene where he's arguing with, not arguing, but he's helping a pregnant alien give birth in a car. She gives birth to this tentacled alien. So they are sort of putting this sort of issue to us. But, you know, what happened was Robert came to us and on Dr. J Radio Live. And he was telling us about what he wanted to do was bring a message out about these aliens that had approached him and had given him these tentacles and said that within the tentacles are properties that would help humanity. And he's finding it very difficult to get anyone to do any research. In 2 years he's had them, not no one wants to touch them and analyze them and give them some sort of light of day. So I've agreed to go and meet Robert in Holland and take him to Germany, where I've got some friends at a university there in Dusseldorf who are prepared to sort of analyze the material that we'll bring. And so, but it's a fascinating story as well because, you know, it's what sort of drives Robert. You know, yeah, he does photographs. Yeah. You know, he's a medium and he helps people. But I mean, in his own drive, he has a full intent to give a message out, which is in some way to tell humanity to be prepared to take on other, you know, beings, and that even the Vatican is prepared to tell us about these things. But, you know, I'll let Robert tell you about the experience.
Yes, thank you, Johnny, for your explanation, and you make it more clear what's going on. Thank you. Yes, it was a very heavy experience for me. It was in 2015 and 15, and then I was lonely at home, and I was get very strong adrift to take my motorbike and go driving to the airfields to Breda Airport, and I was not knowing why. Sometimes I know something will happen, but I was get a feeling I must go out. Because I was expect I will go out to get a fresh nose. Dus I was driving with my motorbike and I was go to Breda Airport. And then I was see in a distance a sort of yellow orange light, in a sort of egg shape, but then an egg shape, you know, not upstairs, but
an egg turned on its side was
exactly
the sky.
Yeah, thank you. Exactly. And Then I was driving, it was sucked me, and I was feel that the light that was in the air, and I know that from other experience, the light that was in the air was having consciousness. It was no me. Yes, I was feel that. And then I was driving with my motorbike closer to the field where the light bulb was hanging, hovering above the field. I was parking my motorbike, and then I was walking a little bit in the field, and then the light bulb was a little bit going higher in the air, and then from one outer blue, out of the blue, two light bulbs was coming out the big egg shape, going downstairs and spinning very hard. Two light bulbs. I remember me it exactly. I see it now again in my mind. They were spinning very quick. And then I will see that some liquid form was coming, and then two creatures was standing there. One bigger creature, one little. Maybe that little creature was a kid, but that higher creature was more growing up, but I'm not sure if that was a kid or that was more, little one, but well, growing up and adult. So I forgive me, creatures, when I'm wrong. But I was standing there, and the first thing that was coming up in my mind was from, oh my goodness, I've never ever seen this sort of creatures. They was having a sort of same shape or from a head, like the greys, with the same type of eyes that the greys have. They was having a torso, but tentacles was coming out, octopus arms, was coming out, different parts of the body. On the breast, but also on the backside. What I was feeling, I was get telepathic in my head that I was having the wish to shake my hand. And I have learned, don't discriminate. Robert, you must prepare people for the life that is on other planets and the different creatures we have in the universe. And people are discriminate each other about skin color or about races and that sort of thing. And I must learn people to prepare them that creatures from other planets look different. And now I was see that I was self thinking, oh my goodness, they look so different. And I have some anxiety, I have some phobia in my life, and that's a phobia for bacterials. And the first thing that I was thinking, it was a scientifically thing that was coming in my mind was, okay, this creature is living in another biotope, in another planet, on another planet. They must have other bacterials. When you go to another country, you must get your shots to protect yourself for the viruses there and the bacterials. Because I was afraid to shake the hand. Then I was getting a sort of voice in my head, not a really voice, but a voice that I was feeling from God, from the presence, from the light of how you will call it, from the source. Don't be afraid. They are creatures. I have made them also. You be safe. And then I was feel, trust God, trust the light. And I was open my hands. And it makes me still a little bit emotional. This tentacle arm, this octopus arm was coming and curl around my hand. And I was feel so much love. I cannot describe it. It was so emotional moment. It was feels the same when you have a baby kitten in your hand and you must feel that you must protect it. But it was also feel very growing up and very powerful. A very strange combination and much higher than I'm self, And that was give me a lots of senses, a lots of positive feeling, from, whoa, this is real. And I will tell people this. And then I was immediately feel the moment that the isolation, I was feel also a sort of energy field around me that was isolate us, that nobody can come between us. And then I was feel that it was disappear a little bit, and that the goodbye moment was coming, the say goodbye moment, that they will go back to the planet where they come from. And then I was getting my head, we will give you something. I was expect maybe a stone, maybe some powder or something. And then there was coming a sort of liquid form around the creatures, and there was coming a spinning light around them, very, very strong. I was not see the forms more. Then there was coming up from the ground, and I was sucked to the egg-shaped ball. And then I was hearing tap, 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 tap in the field. And then I was see that one tentacle, one octopus arm was falling on the ground. And I was saying in my head, is everything going all right with the dematerialization? And I was getting my head, no, we will give you this. Everything is all right, but we will give you this. We will give you some physical evidence that we exist and that us DNA is extraterrestrial. And I was thinking, oh my goodness, is this real or I dreaming? I lost my mind, maybe. It was so real as we sitting here in this chat. And I was, you know, I cannot describe the words for it. I have no words for it. But then, on that moment, they was sucked in more the egg shape, and I was hearing that more things was falling on the ground, and then they was sucked in the ball, and then the ball was disappear, and it was not flying away, but it was more like that when you turn the television out, that it was go away. And then I was watching to the ground, and I was found the octopus arms, and I was do them in a plastic bag that I was having in my motorbike, and bring them to home and lay them down, make pictures from it. And then I was do it, yeah, very strange. Maybe the first thing that I was think what I must do is bring it in the refrigerator, in the freezer. And then it cannot, yeah, go kaput from bacterials or from the air that we have on the earth. And then I was do them in plastic packets and do them in the freezer. And there is really serious no one that will do scientific research to it. I have publicated on my Facebook a couple of times, or somebody will do scientific research to it. Nobody takes it serious. They think, you know, this man is maybe an intention sucker and making things up. And then I'm thinking, you know, when I'm dead, I think that they feel sorry and that they think it was real what he was doing. But I swore it all my life. When I'm lying here, God has the permission to punish me. I'm not a liar. I'm truthful and honest. And I'm happy that now in Germany, the university will do scientific research to it. Yeah.
Okay. Let me say something. We are going to be going to a 5-minute break, and I definitely got to go for 5 minutes. So we'll be right back, and stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. This is a great show brought from Linda and now Robert. Thank you so much for both of you being here. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Nah, bye-bye.
See you later.
You're listening to Wolf Spirit Radio.
Welcome back. Hold on a second. We got a little feedback here. I got it. Welcome back to the Max Steel Show. Listen, folks, we forgot something to give Linda in that return. You know what I mean, Russ? You know what? Whoop. Give her some of that. To all the Native Americans who are listening to the Dusty. Here we go. There we go. What happened, Russ? You're muted, Russ. That's probably we can't hear it. No wonder. My God. All right. Yeah, you go. That's for you, Linda, and all the folks on your people and all the Native Americans everywhere?
Thank you. It sounded like Nephatia.
Nephatia?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Robert missed it. Anyway, I know I told Robert and Johnny that for them to record the show, and we forgot to do that, allow them to record it. But Robert, I know you're listening. Don't worry about it. This show's being recorded from end to end, and it's encrypted here end to end, so nobody can come here and mess things up. So, Robert, when the show will be up tomorrow afternoon or in the early evening, and then you can listen to it while you're listening. It actually downloads. You can download it to your computer.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I forgot to do this at the beginning.
No. No. You tape everything, and then tomorrow we can post it on Facebook and everything. Thank you.
What I wanted to say just for a few seconds here. You know, Johnny and myself and Robert talked last night from 2:30 for about an hour. If I didn't stop Johnny Webb from talking, I would have been here till next week because he likes to talk just like me. But anyway, we talked a lot of good things, and I wanted to try something with Robert, and I told him to close his eyes that I was going to transport myself and tap him on the shoulders.
Yes.
And I said, I'm going to go right there. I'm going to project myself where you're at and touch you in the shoulders. Well, I showed Johnny that I was doing this, you know, like you can't see that in the chat room, but I'm doing it, moving your hand back up and down. I said, Johnny, look at my hands. He's looking at my hand. And all of a sudden I did it for a split of a second. You can't see me when I do it, but I can do it. So I get right I got behind Robert, and I tapped him both of his shoulder at the same time. And then I only did it for a nanosecond or less. I mean, a little bit more, but I did it. And then when I finished, I asked Robert, hey, Robert, what'd you feel? He said, man, I felt like somebody was tapping him both of my shoulder at the same time.
Yes. And one thing is very important. You was say only before you was do this, I will try to come in your kitchen and standing behind you. And you was not say before, I will touch your shoulders. And my eyes was closed, and you was do this. I have heard this from Johnny, and I was feel boom, boom, boom here. This, it was very proofful that it was real what you was do. And that's, we was having an astral contact or a time travel contact. This was very impressive. And you was also do something else before. You was say to me, close your eyes, and Johnny can tell also. And I was close my eyes, I was see only black. And then you was do something, I don't know what, and I was get a flash in my head, whoom, like time shifting, like, or I was make a travel, but it was happening in a couple of seconds. And on that moment that I was feel, when I was having my eyes totally closed and see only black, I was see this flash in my head. And the first thing that I was do automatically was do this. And exactly you was sitting also, you was do this on the serious same second, you was this doing this also. And we was sitting you and me was sitting in this way. And Johnny was see it. I don't know if it is taped, but it was very, very impressive. When I was sitting with my eyes closed and I was doing this, exactly on the moment that you was doing this. And I was coming out the flash of light. It was a very special experience. And you was telling me that now I can more do time travel when I want it. And you was say you want it very strong also. And that's true. I have bring the wish to the universe that I like, that I can do more time travel on the moments that I need or that I want. I have this sort of experience a little bit, but not on the moments that I want. I'm very thankful what you was do.
Thank you, yeah. Robert. See, that's what I was trying to do. I did it on purpose.
Yeah.
So you'll be able to experience it with
It was interesting, to be honest with you, sitting there watching it. You know, because my heart and my soul says you guys are very real, but my sort of rational being pulled down to ground level says, you know, you've got to fight that and inquire and do more research. But my heart goes with it, and I know what's true and what's not true. But I was sitting there watching it, and I have, just like we got these screens here, I had Robert and Max sitting there, and you know, Robert, there was actually a bit more of a delay. It must have been about you know, 2 or 3 seconds before you reacted to his actions, but he clearly showed me, and he could have made any shape, anything, but what he did is he went like that, and then he went like that, and a few seconds later, when his eyes were just completely closed, just completely did the same thing, and went, wow, that was like a mirroring, you know?
Yes, that was
there was
fair.
Something going on.
Yeah.
Okay, what I was trying to do is to show you proof that I can actually show you how to time travel. That's what that energy of light came from one end to the other.
That you
both saw. I know how to do this. I know how to teach this too. I can teach you how to time travel. I can actually show you how to project yourself somewhere else. And I can actually show you that how to project yourself in another space and time or another matrix or another timeline. I can show you how to do very easily because sometimes when we're doing healing on the internet, especially in my sessions, I have to tell the person, listen, at what year did you have that problem? And he said, well, I've had this problem for about 7 years. Okay. So what I do, I go back, I go into the 7 years back and I look in there. And to see what kind of problem is starting to develop for this person. So I said, nah, I got to go back further. So I will go back. This person, let's say an example, would be around 57 years old. Okay. I will go back into the past and go back there and check every 5 years back to see if that person problem is being developed or being created. So if it's not, I go even further back. Change the time of this person in the matrix. Get rid of everything that's there that will manifest this and get rid of it and go back into the future where he's at or that person's at. And then before you know, if he had any type of pain or anything, it will actually, they wouldn't feel it. They'd say, what, Max, what did you do to me? He said, well, what you wanted. He said, well, thank you so very much. I don't feel any more pain. But you know, I do these things. I can teach you how to do all these things. That's what I want to do in my webinar on the 27th, show people how to do this. But I don't have that many people. I haven't had maybe a few or five tell me, but I'm not going to do it if I don't get more than 10 people. But anyway, I'll do it another time. But go ahead and continue with you. I wanted to ask you because you were in a field. Okay. I saw the pictures that you have in your website. I saw this blue UFO disc that was, it wasn't in another parallel world to ours where you couldn't see if you actually saw with your eyes that spaceship. Okay. You won't see it. It's actually in a parallel world with us that we don't see it.
And
that's how they come down and do the crop circles.
Yes.
And I noticed that, you know, I was telling Robert yesterday that I see a swirl of lights, like a spring going into the ground and making those symbols.
Circles. Yes.
Those symbols. Circles. Yeah. Those circles. Yeah. And then that's the way I saw it. And, he said, yeah, that's the way it is. So, you know, if we can talk a little bit about that to the audience here and so they can get more information what all that occurs, it'd be great if you could.
Yes. Thank you that you introduced it a little bit. Yes, it was very impressive. I've seen a couple of times how they was make crop circles. I have seen also some visions that before the day that they will make a crop circle, sometimes a couple of days before, they bring an energetic hologram in the field, and the crop circle is there then, but not physical. It's in the energetic way. And then a couple of days later, the UFO is coming from out the parallel reality, and then whomp, it's 3D reality in us world. And they will very strong help us. They are sort of injections, the crop circles in the ground, in the meridians from the Earth, from Mother Earth, to create a positive energy field to help the collective consciousness from people, bring it planetary on a higher level, that people get more unconditional love, that they can feel more authentic, that they know that life is not an accident, but it's real, and that they must be thankful for the born right that they have get, and that they're starting to be more growing up, more adult in a spiritual way, not in a human way, but more the consciousness that the most people get when they come in the other dimension, when the body is dead, when you go to the other side. That consciousness will have very strong relation with us people and animals on the earth, and also with other creations on other planets. And for me, the most important is the light that is standing above all the star constellations, all the solar systems. Some people call it God, some people call it Whitey, or it have many names. But all the extraterrestrials are coming out the same light from origin, but they have different characters, they have different forms, they can make the same decisions as us, they can also do bad things, they can do good things, but we all know one language, you know, the language on the earth. We have many different languages on this planet in different countries, but one of the languages that we all can hear, can feel, is love. And it's a universal language. And that's very important, that in the simple thing, we can have this contact with from outer's heart. You know, animals are thinking not so much. They don't thinking too much, and they feel more. And that's also some job for us, to don't misuse the mind. Use the mind, but not misuse the mind, and feel more from out the heart. When you think, thinking is not knowing, feeling is knowing. And when we listen to the intuition, we listen to the voice from the light. And when we connect it with this light that's standing above all the star constellations, we must not be afraid to connect with extraterrestrials. We are all a big family. And crop circles are a sort of very gentle arrows that the source above all the star constellations shooting in the collective thinking window that we have created, that we call association. And it creates a sort of holes that we see more a bigger reality. And it comes very gentle in the fields, on nature places, and not on the Big Apple or in New York. It will come very gentle in flat places in nature that people can decide, I believe in it or I not believe in it. And that's a gentle way to not immediately destroy the collective comfort zone from people. And that shows also how gentle the dimensions are. They will not ruinate us. They will bring a new psychological consciousness on this earth. And in the future, the plan is that we all get this consciousness and that we have contact with other planets. We have now on this planet Europe, that's a sort of family with different countries. But we are in the future part with us planet from a sort of Europe, but then in space, from a bigger space political part where we get more rights as humans to be part of a bigger space family. And it's good that the most humans can now only travel in space with rockets or with space shuttles, but not with the techniques from the GFOs. But, you know, we will start immediately a war in space. We must lost the sovereignistic, psychological thoughts, think structures, before we can travel in time and space. In the future, we will, the elites and everything and the whole association can go in space to other planets. But first we must stop discriminate. We first must not discriminate people. They look different, or people say that's an ugly man or an ugly woman. We must stop that. We must make contact with each other. And when we do that, we have the right to also make contact with other planets, and not the first thinking that we, the first idea that we get from, oh, how we can get that planet for us to start a war that we can live on another planet also. Because this sort of ordinary principles must disappear first before we get the right that some aliens have got from the source, the right to travel to time and space. And then in the time we must stay strong and not try to misuse it. And then, yeah, we are in trouble, of course. I hope that before I will leave this planet, I hope open the eyes from a couple of people that they know that life is not an accident, and that they are more life forms, you know, than we know, and they visit us planet. But also that what people call God or the source is much bigger, it's much holier than the religion is telling us. The religion is a belt around God's self that's too tight. God will make a new sort of relation with all the life forms, and extraterrestrial show us that the source or God is much bigger than humans was thinking. He have many houses. There are many planets where life is. Unique creativity. It's much bigger than people expect. It's more magical. It's more beauty than people expect. And I hope that when the whole association is ready to say hello to all the extraterrestrials, that we will say hello to them and that we can help each other, and that we can celebrate that we have got a born right, and that we are part of this beautiful universe. I really wish that. And I'm sure that the time will come. And then they say, you know, that Max Steele was not crazy, and that Robert Vandenbroek was not crazy, and that Linda was not crazy, and all the other people in this chat, they was not crazy. They was right, you know, and it's you see that this sort of things repeat all the time in history. You know, they first say, ah, he's a loon, he's crazy, ignore him. And later they say, yeah, it's true. We have now Tesla cars and, you know, lots of things. There was think first also that he was a fruitcake, and now we know better, you know. But God is testing or we are patient. I think so.
Let me just say one last thing. I happen to agree when you said, and it seems like when you were talking about, you know, that Max is not crazy, Linda is not crazy, and all of us, you know, all this and that, it seems like we have done this already before.
Yes.
All this, yeah. And it's, we're doing it all over again. And
yes, exactly. I think so. Yeah.
And a lot of us here in this, Zoom room that we're in, and also in the chat room, I'm sure they have felt also that they have actually witnessed the same thing repeating itself. Now, there is a question here. And, you know, I kind of like the question for many reasons. It says here, it was sent by, from Regina. She's one of our co-hosts. She says, if the crop circles are emitting radiation, are you not concerned of what it's doing to your body?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Of course, the Professor Livingood have discovered that the cells are changing in the plants, and that must mean that radiation is there, that influences the physical state of the plants. And also he have the idea that microwaves are involved with it. My feeling self is that crop circles are not dangerous physical for people, but I must say that I have experience when the crop circle was formed and it was very fresh. It was there maybe an hour and it was very fresh and very new, that the energy can be too heavy. I was in the past with a lady there, and she was having, how you call it in your teas, from amogan, how you call that, when the dentist is filled a hole in your tea. I cannot hear Johnny, but
the fillings, yeah. Oh, fillings, yeah.
The filling, it was shooting out her tea when she was walking in the circle, and it mean that the electrostatic energy was very strong in that moment. I have never ever hearing that somebody was dying in a crop circle or was get tumors after the person was visit crop circles. But I trust that the formers, the spiritual formers, consciousness forms, they create the crop circles, that they will not make mistakes in it. But I know that the energy can sometimes be very heavy on your head, on your stomach, but I'm still living and I have experienced a lot of energies. Just I trust that they don't make mistakes. They do it only to flat the plants, that the plants, you know, going flat. This, but it, this person was listening with good detail, you know, and it's a serious question that you can ask yourself, you know, is it not dangerous? You know, we know that microwaves are not all the time healthy for people. You know, the magnetrons have it. And, but in the universe, there is also a lot of radiation that's dangerous for us. You know, when we have not some special things around us, then we get cancer. But we need it also for nature to create the sun needed, you know, I think that they give the right doses that we don't die, or otherwise crop circles are dangerous. And then I now for 26 years discovered them. I walk in it. And I'm still living. This I will say I hope that I'm a living example that they are not dangerous. Okay.
Okay.
This is Little Pony. In the two crop circles that I was in, there was energy, and it just kind of feels like when you feel energy around you just daily, you know, how you can feel that energy. It's hard to explain, but if you feel the energy, that's all it was in the crop circles. And when you got out of the crop circles, then it wasn't so energetic.
Exactly. I know exactly what you mean. When I walk in the circle, or other people feel it also, you feel that the energy is normal before, and then you walk in and you can feel a sort of magnetic thing going through your hands. You feel, I expect that you must feel that. Sometimes when you have a rubber balloon and you do this in your hair and you do it over your hairs, you can feel that in a crop circle, and almost everybody feels that. And that's so proofful that something real is going on there. When you walk in it, you feel immediately this sort of magnetic in your blood, sort of.
I feel it somehow sort of drains a lot of energy from the area, because people go in there with their cameras all fully charged, and you know, they have to get out there pretty quick. All their batteries die.
Exactly. Yes. Very good, Johnny. Thank you. Exactly. There is some phenomenal that's everywhere on the world happening when people come in the crop circles. The batteries dying many times, not all the times, but many times. I can show you hundreds of witnesses. They was having this experience. They go in the circle with the photo camera and the batteries dying, and they was filled totally full of energy before. And that shows something real is going on there. And people, when they make pictures, they get many times light on the pictures or the camera, sometimes telephones. I know people with mobile telephones, they go kaput sometimes in the crop circles. The energy is too heavy, but I'm happy. I have never ever hearing that some human was going kaput in the crop circle. This it's, but technique, yeah, is sometimes, yeah, influenced by the energy, and that shows also for the elites, sometimes a little bit the arrogant elitaire scientists, when they do this sort of tests in crop circles, they will get the same results. They know that something is going on, and that not all the crop circles are making by men with planks and boards. There's something real going on. Yeah.
Yeah, I've been in crop circles myself, and I'll be honest with you, I've never felt any energy, but I have actually felt mesmerized by what I'm looking at, you know, to realize that, you know, I was there 10 minutes before it wasn't there, and then I come back and it's there, and it's like, you know, 500 feet wide.
Yeah, very big.
And it's so intricate and interlaced where it's not just one lot of fold, it's woven, you know, they're interwoven, and there's so much detail to it that you realize this isn't Doug and Dave or, you know, 10 guys that go out and make crop circles. And crop circle guys that do go out and make it, it does take them a while. They don't do it in 10 minutes. It takes them all morning or all evening when they do it.
Yeah.
But talking about that, there was a phenomenon where these guys that made the crop circles, they had a team of about 12 people that were doing it. And they were there one night, and someone was up on the hill filming it as it was being made in a sort of slow motion, sort of that it will speed it up and it will all look like fast. But while they were filming, they noticed that they had a 13th person there, an extra person. And this person, when it came up in all the photographs of like the early morning, was jet black. It was like a man in black. It was like a shadow person. You know, there was no, just an outline of like almost like a gingerbread man sort of shape of a humanoid looking, but pitch black, sort of that black that just sort of sucks everything into it.
Yes.
And so even these crop circle people that make them, they used to even say this. I went to a place in it's called the Barge Inn, and it's down in Devizes, right near to Silbury Hill, and it's in that sort of Stonehenge area. And it's a lot of crop circle sort of seriologists go and meet up there, and they go and have a meet up about not just crop circles, but about, you know, the phenomenon of UFOs and also the deep underground military bases that's underground there in Salisbury. But when I was there, I had a meet up, and what we saw was when I was talking to these guys that were crop circle makers, and they were telling us about this story, they were saying that what they get, and this was quite weird because you think, okay, it's humans that are making it, we can put it all to bed. But what they were saying was, is they get a dream of a plan in their head that night or the night before, and then they go out and make it at the very last minute with this plan that's just come to their fault. So it's like spontaneous making. It's not, you know, 10 weeks in the making or something. It's like literally the night before. And to me, that was a sort of some sort of phenomenal interaction, even between these non-believers that think they're doing it on their own accord.
Yes, that's also, I think that the real crop circle makers, the consciousness forms, they will show them that something real is going on. I've also hear from some hoaxers that was on television telling that they was making some crop circles in England, but that they was see also light bulbs that was coming when they was do it. And that shows for them, you know, you are not the only person that make this. There's something real. Don't forget us. It's not a joke. And I know, and I'm very happy that they are real crop circles. They, where not human hands and feet was coming between, that was really coming out the other dimension, and that give people trust and hope that something is real and more witnesses see it, and yeah, that makes me happy.
Well, one of the crop circles being made, you know, it's a very famous one in England in a place called Oliver's Castle, and it shows these orbs that come in and swirl round, and literally you see the field just sort of unfold before it. And I've seen those orbs, you know, in the same sort of area. And, you know, we call it ball lightning in a way in England, which they associated to the ley lines and energy.
Yeah.
It's sort of electric. They sort of can associate it more to an electric ball charge rather than some phenomenon that's got its independent intelligence. You know, it's, if you see three or four of them, they're all independent intelligence. It's not some sort of run of energy. It's interesting, you know.
Very interesting.
I noticed in some of your videos on your robertvandenbroek.com page that you've got some videos of the actual balls coming down, these spheres, and, you know, manifesting themselves to you. And then you said that then you've seen in the field these small circles, you know, not impressive like a 500 meter one, but
sometimes very small, yeah.
You've told me that the energy in a small environment is sometimes much more, you know, bigger and impressive than, say, a big crop circle that in some cases has very low energy. But it's the tiny little ones that are connected off of it that have most of the charge there. Can you give us more information on that?
Yes. I have discovered sometimes very big circles, but sometimes also very little circles. And sometimes they are so little, they can fit in my hand, very little. Then you think they will having maybe not so many energy. Sometimes I was standing in a very little baby circle, and it was feel for me as I was standing on the top of a very high hill. It was feel if I can touch the sky. It was feel so energetic. I was feel that I was coming very high in the universe. And that shows also that we must not discriminate, that we must not be egotistical, that we must having big, fancy, glitzy and glamour circles. No, that also this one little baby circle can be very powerful. And that was a lesson, you know, don't watch too much to images, you know, make contact with the energy. And more important is what is behind the phenomenals. The crop circles are not so important. What's behind the crop circles? What is the message and the consciousness that will have a relation with us? That's important. And I was get that lesson on that moment. And I try to learn people that, you know, it's funny in some way. It's, you know, you, I was like the baby circle. Yeah.
I want to change gears a bit and just go over some of the other stuff that you've worked with over the time. And some of it was being a medium. And for Americans, that you know, like most of the people here this evening, they heard about a case of a girl called Natalie Holliday or Holloway. And she'd gone on holiday with a, you know, school and went to an island called Aruba.
Mm-hmm.
And then she met up with a Dutch guy that you know a gentleman that knows that gentleman personally. And, mm-hmm. and this Dutch guy who had been associated to her death, and his father was the governor or one of the judges on the island. And so there was sort of some skullduggery with everything, and it wasn't in the light of day. And still to this day, the parents are still wondering what's happening with their daughter.
Yeah.
And you told me quite recently that you'd had some thoughts about what's happening, and also in your photographs, you actually had her come to you in your sessions of these photographic experiences. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yes, it's in cases that's very sensitive cases. Of course, it's a very sensitive case. Natalie Holloway is disappeared now for lots of years, and it's terrible for the parents, and they get every time still hope that they will find her body, and they don't find her body. It's terrible. But Joran van der Sloot was in jail, And on the moment, he was first a free man after the Natalie Holloway cases. And after that, he was murdered a lady in Peru, Stephanie Flores, in the hotel. And then, of course, the police was take him and bring him to jail. And he's sitting there now, very high in the hills. But he I was not know him personally, but I was get a letter from his lawyer that he was see an apparition from a man in his jail. And that man was say, I'm Robert Vandenbroek and I'm here to help you. And I'm a medium from the Netherlands, but I was, but Joran was think that I was a dead person, that he was an apparition, got an apparition from a dead person, and he was see a lots of light in his jail, and he was feel a lots of love, and he was feel a sort of regression from what he was done, how bad it was, but also that he must learn to love himself again. And yeah, that was very heavy. And then I was get a letter from his lawyer that he was having this experience, and his lawyer was discovering on the internet that I was still living, but that I was having some gifts.
Let's just hold that point for a second, Robert, because I just want to give you some information. Robert, that's not the only person that has had apparitions of Robert appear in their living rooms, in their car while they're driving, in their court appearances, even where one of his friends had moved to Spain and he woke up in the morning and walked into his kitchen and there was Robert standing in his kitchen and he's like, yeah, what's going on? But then he realized, I got a camera, and he went and got a camera and took this photo of this apparition of Robert, yeah, in his kitchen.
That's absolutely true, yeah.
But let's be, I'll be honest with you. Robert's always told me it's not him being there and having a recollection of it. It's when he's in his quiet mode somewhere, he second self goes on a mission and he doesn't realize it. So exactly, bring you back to where he is. He's now getting a phone call from a lawyer in Peru, from a client in jail, you know. Go ahead, Robert.
Yes, yes. And after that experience, I was I was sitting on my sofa in the living room, and then I was seeing from out of the blue Joran sitting in his jail. It was looked like of a hole was going open, and I was see him sitting, and I was ask him, can you see me? And he was say, yes, I can see you. And I was ask him, is it okay that I talk with you? And I was feel a lots of love coming to him. And then I was ask him, when this is real, can you say a code that we decide to say a word to me that your lawyer can prove that it is real? And I was seeing that he was thinking, he was sitting on his bed, and I was see that he was trying to make something up, and then he was say white horse. I was get it very clear, and then I was sucked back in the sofa. I was not going out my body real for my feeling, but then I was going back in my body, and I think a week later, maybe 2 days after a week further, I was getting an email from his lawyer that Joran was see me again, or there was something going on with the coat. And I was say, oh my goodness, is that, but that the lawyer was say, I have not the permission to tell it you. Joran will test you or you know it. And then I was say, oh my goodness, is that something with white horse? And his lawyer was say, I get goosebumps. It was true. That was very proofful that something astral was happening there. Now, after that, that was, of course, a more well-known cases. But I'm now having for years that I appear in living rooms from people. People see me. I have got hundreds of letters from people. They see me over the whole world. They, sometimes I give a message to them. Sometimes I remember me it, but most of the times I don't remember me itself. It's more my higher self that is doing that. Some security camera have filming me also, that I was somewhere in the living room from somebody, and you see a light that was coming in the living room. And then she was seeing me, and her husband was seeing me also. And yeah, that's very proofful that something real is going on. But Natalie Holloway is a missing cases, and a missing cases that was got a lots of media attention over the whole world. But there are lots of people missing, and that's the same important for me. You know, not it's very sad when you lost a child in a missing cases. That's the most terrible nightmare that you can happen. But I was get now the last, I think in 2014, I was get very strong the message from Natalie Holloway, her spirit, that she that her spirit is try to push me very hard. That the police is going to the St. Anna Cemetery on Aruba, and that there is a grave that already exists with bones from some dead person in it, but that the criminals have buried her bones in that grave, and the police will not expect that she is in a grave. They will expect that she is in the ocean, and because they have buried her there. Then I was getting a letter out of the blue from a lady that was not knowing that I was got that message. And she was say, I get all the time St. Anna in my mind and that she is in a grave there. Then a couple of weeks later, I was get number 15, grave number 15 in my head. And then that lady was writing me. She was say, I get number 15 in my head. And now I try to make the authorities on the island and the police ready to open the grave to watch or her bones are there. And I've talked now with a man in the Netherlands. He's a crime fighter, and he have tell that there are more signals from out the association from Joran that she is there, that her bones are there. And that makes it for me that I cannot sleep good more when I knowing that, and they do nothing now. But I try to fight. I make now a letter for justice there, for the police there, or they will try to open the grave, or they will scan it. They have sort of sonar machines that they can scan us, or there are two bodies in it. This is in heavy cases. Yeah. I hope that they take it seriously. One person will say, can you not fly to Aruba and open self the grave secretly? I will say, no, I cannot do that. You know, then I go in jail. And yeah, it's not respectful to do that. Because I will official that the police do it. And I have done more missing cases in the past, and I've also found a man back. You can see that also on YouTube. He was missing for 40 years, and there was expected that they will not found him back, and they have found him back. And you can see it also. I was get a message that he is in Paris, that he is still living, and that he was living by an antique shop, and they have found him there. And nobody was knowing. Also the police not. There was take a look there, and they have found him there. And there are more from this sort of cases. I will show that I'm not talking poop, you know, that I'm not try to sound interesting or pretend that I've been something, you know. It's. I was wishing that I was not having this gift sometimes. It's not. People think that it is all the time interesting, but you have not a really private life. No, it's very hard. It's there 24 hours. I'm not working with it, but I live with it. Yeah.
Is the Holloway case still open or is it closed?
It's still open. It's still open, but they have give an official explanation publicly that they are sure that she's dead. But they have not found her. In the past, there was a lots of people that was making stories up to get money. It's very terrible that they know where she is, or to get media attention, or I don't know what the motives was. But I think that the parents are very tired now after all this sort of circus things. I think that it's very perverse what's going on around these cases. It's terrible. I hope for the parents from Natalie that they can find the bones there, and that she can get a monument, and that they can burn candles there, And that's good for the soul from Natalie and good for the parents. Yes, I hope. We should see. Yeah.
Well, we had a question here, but I don't think we have time to answer it because we're got less than 5 minutes. Well, 5 minutes.
Okay.
let's see if we can answer it. Go ahead, Sean, and read it to our guest.
Okay.
Regarding the crop circles, are these are most likely multidimensional crop circles. Do you think they're directed at humans or the non-humans that are on this planet? And what are the message? And what are the messages? Because it seems that there's some kind of mathematical equation in some of them.
Yeah.
And it's a multidimensional equation that exactly. I guess directed for someone who's going to understand it. Most likely.
Yes. It's of course the knowledge from the subconsciousness. The geometric forms are the language from the universe and from the collective subconsciousness. But it's something non-human. It's coming from a higher consciousness that's absolutely non-human. And we all with us collective consciousness create the crop circles also a little bit. Just it's partly a little bit human. That's starting to get a relation with the non-human consciousness. It's a big mystery. I don't know exactly what's going on. When I think that I know it, I will discover that I not know it. It's a very big mystery and I love it. You know, it's too big for us humans to understand it. But when we not will explain it and we experience it, we jump to a higher level. As I have discovered, you know, I must not try to understand it with my mind. But then I starting to be very nervous and then it leave me a little bit. And of course you have very intellectual people and I'm very proud of them, what they do. You know, they try to explain what the circles are meaning and they calculate and that's also a good creative way to deal with it. But I'm not the type for it. I give it and I feel and that's more my job. I cannot calculate. I have discalculation problems. But maybe that makes me a right medium. I don't know. I've no questions. I've not too much questions. Yeah.
Okay, remember, folks, Wolf Spirit Radio is a self-supported station. Please donate whatever you can afford. It's fine. $1, $2, $5, you know, please donate to Wolf Spirit Radio. That way we can bring all these great, awesome guests on my show and other shows that are played here in Wolf Spirit Radio. And I know we got just a few minutes left. And I want to thank our friend here, Robert. Robert, I do want to bring you back another time for the show. And I would
thank you, Max. Thank you. And thank you that I appreciate it very much that you was give me the opportunity to tell people my experience. And God bless you. And God bless all the listeners now also. Thank you. Well,
thank you for that, too. And our first guest, it was Linda. Thank you for being courageous in bringing the information to the public because that takes guts. And I know that the Native Americans have a lot of secrets about different types of other healing. So if you know some of those, we'll bring you back and do a full show of 2 hours with you. Also want to thank Regina for my co-host, my beautiful wife, Nicole. And by the way, Nicole, I just want to say to you, that I love you very much and thank you for always supporting me.
I love you too.
Thank you.
Yeah, love you all. Thank you.
And our friend Vanessa, thank you for being here. Friend Johnny Webb, you will hear more about Johnny Webb more later on in the time of other shows. And bring in Delight, Sean, he's with us too. And my bodyguard, who's very strong and very little, but she's got one heck of a temper, and that's a Little Pony. And I didn't get I didn't get any trouble today, not even with Vanessa. She watches what I say. But there she is. She's got a beautiful smile. Anyway, and also the people in the chat room that put up with me all for the last 2 hours. I didn't say much. I let the guests do more because there's a lot of information. All right. Thank you, everyone, for being on the show and everywhere else. This is Max Steele. See you next week. We have a great guest next week. Take care. Bye-bye. I love you all.
Thank you, Max.
Thank you. Thank you, Max. Thank you all.